Hey everybody, just a little note before the show starts. We just want to let you know that the audio that you're going to hear sounds drastically different than what you're normally used to. And that's just simply because we recorded on location at the D23 Expo. And there's a lot of background noise, so I just want to give you a heads up that it's going to be different than what you're normally used to with our show. And I tried my best to kind of make it work, but hopefully it's good enough for you guys and you guys enjoy. Thanks, and enjoy the show.
Hi, and welcome to the Theme Park Duo podcast. Grab your park map, churro, and hop in line with us as we take you on a coast-to-coast adventure through the world of theme parks, haunts, conventions, and more. Now, here's your hosts, Nikki and Gabriel.
And welcome back to another theme park-filled adventure with our ridiculousness. I am one of your hosts, Gabriel.
And I'm your other host, Nikki.
And by the way, the show is Theme Park Duo. I probably should have said that somewhere as well. That's part of the ridiculousness.
You are ridiculousness.
I am the embodiment of ridiculousness. To a certain extent, at least. I have my moments.
You do, of clarity?
Yeah. Yeah. Why does it sound like I'm insane? I'm not insane. Or am I?
Dun, dun, dun.
Moment of clarity.
I'm just as insane.
That's true.
Yeah.
If you're married to me, you must be insane.
That's what people keep telling me.
What? Who says that? Who says that? I'm going to go give him a piss in my mind.
I'm just going to let you think about that.
That's not
Try
fun.
To figure out who told me that.
I'm coming for you. Insert name. Anyway, welcome to the show, everybody. So today's episode is going to be a little different. We actually were at the D23 Expo in Anaheim, California, and we recorded the whole episode there.
Yeah, it's all live at the Expo, or not live, because we're here now. You know what I mean.
We recorded on the floor.
On location.
On location, so that the vibe of the Expo is in the background and in the recording, as well as the fact that we're giving our immediate reactions to what we saw and what we heard with all the panels that we went to. So we went to quite a few panels, saw a lot of stuff on the floor, things like that. So just we really wanted to have initial reactions because that's kind of what it is. I mean, yeah, sometimes you need a little time to kind of digest information and stuff like that. But I feel like with this, it was important to kind of get our immediate reaction because everyone was talking about this stuff. So
yeah, definitely. And, yeah, it's our most genuine reaction to what we heard and saw and experienced. And there are even a few guests that joined us.
Yes, we have a couple of surprise guests joining us near the latter end of the episode after the Parks and Resorts panel that we went to. And they chime in on their thoughts on what all these announcements meant to them and things like that. So I'll leave it at that, and we have a couple gentlemen that'll be joining us later. So super fun, and why don't we not hesitate any longer and just get into the episode.
Enjoy.
Tonight we're going to share a wonderful dream come true together. In 1955, an amazing man named Walt Disney dreamt of a magic kingdom.
Welcome to this happy place. Welcome. Disneyland is your land. Here age relives fond memories of the past, and here youth may savor the challenge and promise of the future. Disneyland is dedicated to the ideals, the dreams, and the hard facts that have created America, with the hope that it will be a source of joy and inspiration to all the world.
Hello, everybody. So you listened to our intro of the show, and now you're here live. Not really live, well, kind of, sort of, not. Yeah, not live at all.
Just move on, Gabe.
Okay, moving on. You're here with us at the D23 Expo in Anaheim, California. It is the Disney fan event where so many people are converging into one place to celebrate such a fun
atmosphere and one topic that everybody loves.
Gabe, they already heard the intro. We already gave the intro. You just gave intro number two.
That's fine.
You just gave a pre-recorded intro to the post-recorded intro that they already heard.
Well, good, because my future self will be very thankful that he doesn't have to do that much work. But we're here sitting in line for the Legends, Disney Legends panel. Unfortunately, I had to actually go get my temporary gold membership card for D23, and Nikki, you came in way before me.
Yeah, I've been waiting in line since like 5:30. It's like, what, 7 right now?
Currently 7:55.
I watched the entirety of the movie Moana while I was in line. There's people still sleeping in sleeping bags in line. It's quite an event.
Yeah, a lot of people showed up really, really early. People showed up last night and started camping out, and then they got moved inside. So me seeing that on Twitter, I stopped looking on Twitter because I got really anxious.
Yeah, but your fears were eased a bit when you came in here and you saw that half the space is still available.
Yeah, so there are large lines and people are waiting, but everything seems to be within moderation, and there's still a lot of room for people to actually come into the panel.
Yeah,
which is nice. Met a lot of really fun people who were in line, and that made the time fly by. So I finally got mine, and then I had to get in line to come in here, and the line was huge. But to Disney and the Expo staff, to their credit, their security line and ticket scanning line moved very, very, very quickly, and I was able to get back in pretty fast. So as of right now, that's all really we have experienced. We'll come back to you, and next time you hear us, we'll come out of the Disney Legends panel, and we'll chat about that.
Yeah, we'll tell you all about Oprah.
Oprah, you get a Disneyland, and you get a Disneyland.
Oh, I wish.
And you get a Disneyland, but there's not that many Disneylands, so only one person's really
Well, she has to build them. She just, like, buys, like, I don't know, the Sahara Desert and just builds a whole bunch of Disneylands in there.
But maybe it's, like, Oprah Land instead.
Oh, it would be Oprah Land.
It's Oprah Land, and instead of, like, Splash Mountain, like a mountain, you're coming out of her head, like out of her mouth, that's like a tongue.
That's so gross. There's a whole land dedicated to her puppies, her dogs.
And then there's a Stedman land that's just like completely boring, and then he's just all a bunch of Stedman standing around doing nothing. Okay, we've really diverged from Disney. Okay, moving on. Next time you hear us, we'll talk to you about the Disney Legends panel.
Be right back. Never had a friend, never had a friend, you ain't never had a friend, never had a friend, you ain't never had a friend.
Had a friend like me. Hello, and we're back. We are currently waiting in line for the Pirates panel that is going on in the D23 Expo Arena. We got out of the Legends panel, which was much longer than I thought it was going to be.
It was 2 hours. It was very long.
It was significantly longer than I expected, but it did give a lot of time and dedicated a lot of time to each person that was getting the award, which was kind of nice.
Yeah, it was actually like a real award ceremony, so that was nice.
Yeah, so it was really cool. We have the list of people here that were actually there.
Okay, so we have the list of people who actually were recognized today and inducted into the Disney Legends group. So first was Oprah Winfrey, and she... Sorry.
Nikki totally spit on my face while recording.
Oprah.
Oh, don't do that to the mic. Oprah Winfrey.
Oprah was first. And before each person, they showed like a little video.
A montage.
Their life and their accomplishments and things like that.
Which was really cool.
Yeah. And okay, so I don't remember the list.
Yeah, it's fine. We'll just go through the list.
Okay.
That's totally fine.
Yeah.
So there's Oprah Winfrey, Julie Taymor, who worked on a lot of different Broadway stuff. She worked on Lion King. Gary Marshall, who is a very, very famous executive producer. Laverne and Shirley, Happy Days, things like that. Stan Lee, everybody knows him. Excelsior, he even said it.
He did.
We have Jack Kirby. Jack Kirby is an illustrator in comic books. So honestly, the way I said it, like we were waiting in line, someone was like, who's Jack Kirby? I was like, there wouldn't be a Stan Lee if there wasn't a Jack Kirby.
They were coworkers for a long time.
Yeah, so they both really developed Marvel together. Wayne Jackson, Mark Hamill, obviously from Star Wars, Luke Skywalker himself, Manuel Gonzalez, who was a animator, and he also did a lot of the newspaper cartoons of Mickey Mouse, Whoopi Goldberg, Clyde Geron, I don't know how to say his last name.
Geronimy,
there you go, and Carrie Fisher for everything she did for the Walt Disney Company, obviously after she passed away.
Yes.
It didn't seem like there was a moment during her portion where anybody... It was heavy the entire time.
It was, yeah.
It was very heavy, and then also, particularly because Stan Lee's wife had passed away not too long ago, there was a lot of heaviness in the air because of that as well when he came up. You could tell he was very touched by everything, and he was emotional.
Very emotional. He seemed very honored, and very honored that they also, inducted his friend and coworker for so many years.
Yeah, Jack Kirby.
Yeah, and made him a legend as well. I think he appreciated that more than becoming a legend himself.
Yeah, it really did seem like it. And I really enjoyed the panel itself. I thought it was great. There seemed to be a few little snafus here and there with music and things that were going off when they shouldn't have been going off. But small, itty-bitty, nitpicky details.
Are we just not going to talk about the Dancing with the Stars dance musical numbers?
I was gonna bring that up. So, I mean, you could talk about that.
Oh, it's just an interesting addition to the ceremonies was two kind of breaks from the actual ceremonies where they did, musical numbers where people were singing, and then they had the Dancing with the Stars professional dancers come out and do musical numbers.
Yeah, so the first one was for
Marvel,
and then the second one was for Haunted Mansion.
The Haunted Mansion one was actually really cool because they brought out the cadaver dance. They did the Haunted Mansion theme music.
Yeah, and they were dancing to that, which was really, really cool.
Yeah, and so they had someone dressed up as the bride, one of the dancers, and that one was cool. That one was fitting. The other one, I don't know. It was
left
a little weird.
A little to be desired.
Yeah.
Other than that, Bob Iger was the person who was really the host of this entire thing, so that was really cool to see the CEO of Disney, Walt Disney. That's crazy.
Yeah, that was pretty cool.
So, at the end, of course, he threw in a little surprise. The cast of Lion King showed up and actually did a number there, which was really, really cool.
Yeah, it was really fun to watch. The Lion King is the Broadway show I've always wanted to see. I've never seen it yet, so...
So you got a little taste.
I got a little taste of it. It was fun.
And then frickin' Oprah the entire time doing Oprah things. Every person that went up was like, Oprah knows this story. Oh, it's Oprah. Oprah knows that. Hey, Oprah. It's like, Oprah, you're everywhere. And then she even was talking about going to eat dinner at Steakhouse 55 last night. And you said something funny. I forgot what it was, though.
I said, I bet everyone in the audience was like, dang, I should have gone to Steakhouse 55 last night.
I wish I was eating at Steakhouse 55 next to Oprah. Maybe she would have bought me my steak.
She ate alone.
Poor lady.
Oh,
where's
so
Stedman?
Sad. I don't know.
And no, we did not get free Disneylands. Nobody got free anything.
No.
It was crap.
We didn't even get confetti.
There was confetti falling from the ceiling, so I thought there was going to be confetti.
I think it's for a later panel.
Hopefully.
Yep.
But yeah, so Legends panel was really, really fun right now. We're currently waiting, like I said, in the line for the Pirates panel, which should be really, really cool.
Yeah.
And we're going to be relaxing here with a soda pop and some treats. And what better way to do the D23 Expo with some treats, right?
Right, of course.
Okay, guys, so we're going to take care for now, and then we're going to talk to you guys after we get out of the Pirates panel.
Yeah, bye.
Bye. Okay, we're back, everybody. It is actually day two right now. Nikki and I were very, very, very tired at the end of the day yesterday and conked out. We got here at 6 in the morning?
6:30.
Which was a mistake to a certain extent. The line to get into the expo was stretched down the center walkway of the entire convention center. And it wasn't a line, it was just a mass of people.
It was rather stressful and nerve-wracking.
It was very, very stressful, and it just seemed like there was a lack of planning on their part for the amount of people that are going to be coming here. And honestly, something that I said to you that I genuinely believe is I think D23 has outgrown the Anaheim Convention Center.
To an extent, yes. The actual... convention center is big enough. It's the outside. I feel like in San Diego, they have a lot more space outside to form lines and things like that. There's really no space outside here.
If anything, I would think that they would need to kind of restructure the outside, redesign the outside so that it allows for more space for people. And if you hear a lot of noise in the background, by the way, they are playing Star Wars. Which one is this? Star Wars? It's Rogue One. They're playing Rogue One right now on the TV, so if it's a little loud in the background, we apologize. I'll try to take it out and post a little bit better for you guys. But anyway, last night, the last panel that we did was the 50th anniversary, or 60th anniversary, one of the two. 50th anniversary of Pirates of the Caribbean, the attraction.
Yeah. So they had a lot of past and present Disney employees and Imagineers there. Tony Baxter was there.
Marty Sklar was there.
Several others.
Yeah, there was quite a few people.
They have people who are like just now working and who had worked on constructing Shanghai Disney Pirates. So that was cool to hear about that one.
Yeah, and it was actually a really cool thing just to be able to go through its history and kind of its inception, and especially given the fact that the panel was created and made up of people who have worked on Pirates of the Caribbean since its inception to the brand spanking new iteration of it.
Yeah.
So you get like this really cool scope of perspective on the attraction, how their emotions are towards it, how they grew up liking it, and hearing somebody who developed it, to Tony Baxter, who snuck in to go look at it, to other people who have been wanting to make a Pirates of the Caribbean ride since they became designers.
Yeah.
So it was really interesting to hear that. One thing that did happen was, you know, of course, somebody in the panel mentioned the changes that are going to be coming to the parks, and it already happened in France, in Paris Disney. The changing of the auction sequence, and the crowd started to boo. Actually, verbally boo and rant and yell.
And no one who was on the panel has any decision-making power over that. You know, they were all just people there to talk about the ride.
Yeah, and honestly, I'm not going to lie, I was embarrassed just being in the room when that happened. I was just embarrassed being of that crowd.
But it was shut down pretty quickly.
They let them do it. You know, they could tell that it was probably going to happen. And pretty much Marty Sklar shut him down by essentially saying, change is a tradition in Disneyland. Things are always changing. Things change from day one to day two to day three to day four to day five. What was always there, changing things, making things better, and just making things different.
Yeah.
And to complain about a change to an attraction now is essentially going against like Disney tradition. So he got a huge round of applause, and like some people even stood up to applaud him for that statement. And I think he's right. You know, as much as you and I are definitely against the change of the scene, I know me in particular, I just love the scene. I love the way the ride is in its entirety, the way it is now. I do think he's correct that Disneyland is always changing. It will always change.
Yeah.
And it's just part of its history and part of its tradition, and it's going to continue on regardless of whether or not we want it to.
I think, I don't know if people are more upset about the fact that it's changing at all or they think it's changing because, like, Disney's afraid of someone, you know, calling PC police on them or, you know, sexism or whatever, you know. Like, I think it's the reasons behind the change more than the change.
I totally agree.
Is it change for an improvement, or is it change just for the sake of sticking out of trouble, you know?
No, I completely agree. And ultimately, none of us really know what the actual
motivation
behind it is, whether or not it was a PC change or whether or not they just thought that it deserved a change at all, like a refreshing change to it, because that scene has been like that for a long time. And, you know, it was funny. I forgot whose article it actually was. But somebody did mention that the flow and the style and the vibe of the ride has changed significantly over the years, especially with the addition of Jack Sparrow. And because of his addition, the auction scene doesn't quite fit and make as much sense as it did prior to his addition. Because before, it was a satire, you know, they were pillaging, plundering, and at the end, they pretty much blew themselves up. They were drunkenly blowing themselves up. You know, that was kind of the whole joke was, you know, they're doing all these terrible things, but that in the end, they're going to be their own end. They're going to kill themselves, essentially. Now the end is Johnny Depp getting away with it, plundering in his loot, happy. And I think ending it on the vibe of, hey, if you do all this bad stuff, you're going to get away with it and you're going to be great. You know, I think that vibe is completely different than what it is or what it used to be.
Yeah.
So it does kind of make sense to change it to make it kind of fit it a little bit better. You know, the rides, pacing, and scenes do fit in some spots, but collectively don't really go together that well anymore because of that change.
Yeah.
Another really cool thing that they had mentioned, and just, you know, ultimately I keep saying it's like the stories that are coming from these people are just incredible, are stories of the attraction being built and testing it and building the scenes and like dragging people through. They dragged Walt through the model of it in a chair.
Yeah.
You know, and just hearing the inside stories of these really incredibly, incredibly famous attractions. It's just so cool.
They were saying they even did that with the new Shanghai Disney ride, so things haven't changed all that much. They were testing out how certain things were going to look by dragging someone by it really quickly on a chair.
Yeah. And it was funny listening to the designers of the people who worked on the Shanghai Disney and Pirates ride, as well as just Pirates Cove and just that whole themed area. They were mentioning that one of the designers who worked on a lot of the different water rides in the industry was telling them that you'll learn that water tells you what to do when you're building it. And they're like, oh, yeah, we'll figure that out. And when they built their Pirates, they realized that the water was pooling over in the boarding area and they didn't know why.
Yeah.
So they kind of really had to figure out what was going on and why. And I found that really, really funny.
Yeah,
that you know, funny. Even at this point in the stage and in the game, people who have been designing rides for a long time, or even like how much technology we have, water is still going to be your biggest enemy.
It's still trial and error to a certain extent.
Exactly. Tell that to the people who designed Jaws, the ride in Orlando, right? They had to redo that entire ride, for goodness sake. That's ridiculousness.
That's also bad planning.
That's bad planning and bad building and everything. So there was a lot more going on there than there was here, but
you get
the idea of what you're saying. But that panel was really, really fun. And Nikki, currently, where are we?
We are in line for the Parks and Resorts panel.
Yes, so there was insanity for the live action panel, and so there was a lot of commotion, but then it seemed as though the unofficial line officially turned into the official line relatively soon after that kind of started to clear up.
Well, yeah, they weren't letting people queue up for Parks and Resorts because people were still filing into the live action, so people just kind of started to linger for the Parks and Resorts panel, and it kind of became an official line after a while. So, but it all kind of worked out. We have a pretty good spot.
Yeah, no, it totally worked out. I mean, Nikki and I actually got the gold membership D23 card for this weekend in particular, just so that we could get into the gold sections. And it's been working out great for us, personally. I just think the only issue being is the organization in which people are being placed into Hall D23, and things just getting mixed up, and then regular gets mixed with gold, and then people get mad.
Yeah, I think they're just not separating they're not spacing out when they let people file in, so people end up cutting and shoving and kind of mixing together, you know, so it's a little unorganized.
Yeah, I think unorganized is the correct word. I think there's not enough communication going on as well throughout the expo. You know, there's cast members and people working the expo who have different information. Like, you can get four different pieces of information from four different people. Like, hey, where's the line start? You ask four people, four different answers. And that's an issue.
Yep.
And I think we, honestly, because we're recording little bits different throughout the days and recording separately, I don't remember what I've said in the past, but he didn't see me. We saw somebody we know, and I got denied. That's so sad. Every 2 years that the expo happens, so they don't remember the issues that happened those years, and then the people are different, so they don't remember it either. So it's different every single time you have the expo.
Yeah, and they keep introducing new things like this. This gold member special line is completely new this year, so it's something that they have never had to deal with before, so they're kind of learning as they go too. So we'll see if they bring it back in 2019.
Yeah, we'll see.
Yeah.
I have a feeling they will.
Yeah.
And they'll probably end up changing some stuff up.
I'm sure.
Maybe not for the better, but just to change it.
Yeah.
Because that seems like their MO.
Yeah.
So, anyway, we're going to leave you off there. We still have a good, 2.5 hours to wait before we get into the Parks and Resorts panel, where we're waiting to hear a lot of news about foreign parks and domestic parks, news about Epcot, news about possible Avengers attractions or Marvel lands.
So exciting! I can't wait.
Really, really hoping to hear some really big news today. And I was about to tell them to make sure to follow us so they could listen.
It's not the end of the show yet.
Not even the end of the show. It's not live. I'm not live tweeting. I am live tweeting, but they don't know this because it's way after on Monday. So sorry, guys. Didn't mean to excite you there and plug for
prematurely plug.
Whoops, I have a problem with that.
Aw, yeah. Man, you guys should work on that.
Okay, guys, we'll catch you after the Parks and Resorts panel, okay?
Yay, bye.
We just got out of the Parks and Resorts panel, and there was so much announced. A butt ton of news. And butt ton is a form of weight and measurement.
Yes, it is.
Of course.
Uh-huh.
Okay, just to give you a list of things, because we'll give you everything that they're doing. So, Star Wars Galaxy's Edge, which is the official name of the new Star Wars lands that are coming to Walt Disney World as well as Disneyland. They gave us details on that. Mickey Mouse ride for Hollywood Studios. There's a Ratatouille ride coming to France. New seamless Circle Vision ride for China. New Epcot entrance. Guardians ride replacing Universe of Energy. They showed a lot of pictures of that too. And it looked like Universe of Energy even though they didn't say it. Let's see here. New green mission for Mission Space. New space restaurant for Future World. New Disney's Riviera DVC Resort, new immersive Star Wars hotel for Walt Disney World, Marvel retheme of New York Hotel in Paris, minivans, personal transportation system with Walt Disney World, so that's like Lyft and Uber and all that stuff. Skyliner gondola transportation system for Walt Disney World, new theater for Magic Kingdom Main Street, new Beauty and the Beast, that's what that is, Beauty and the Beast, Disney Cruise Lines, seventh ship for Disney Cruise Lines, and then they're going to add more ships. Toy Story Land, updates on that in Orlando and Shanghai, open 2018. Pixar Fest for both Anaheim Parks, summer 2018. Paint the Night moves to DCA with a new float. Pixar Play Parade moves to Disneyland. Paradise Pier now becomes Pixar Pier. Halloween overlay for Cars Land called Hall-oween. Hall spelled H-A-U-L, of course. And then, last but not least, Marvel Land for DCA, Spider-Man, and Avengers will be focused on. So, there is quite a lot of things to focus on. Now, Nikki, out of all the things that we heard today, what was one of your favorite things?
Let me think. Man, that's,
you
a,
wanna look at
that's
the list?
A long list, yeah.
Look at the list. She's thinking. I'll direct you. We're currently walking. As it is. We're in line because we'll share something special after Nikki says what she needs to say.
I guess the Mickey ride in Hollywood Studios is pretty cool.
Yeah, the Mickey ride seems really neat. Now, a lot of the rides that they were mentioning, they never mentioned what they were going to take over. They didn't say what they were going to close.
Yes.
So, like, clearly the Guardians of the Galaxy ride is going to be taking over Universe of Energy, so Ellen's Energy Adventure, and then the Mickey ride is rumored. The rumor was that it was taking over Great Movie Ride. I think that's what's happening. They didn't mention it. A lot of the bigger things they didn't mention. For me, what was really exciting is they brought out one of the Imagineers that worked on Epcot when it was being developed. And what I find nice about that is they're using him as the Keystone Imagineer to redevelop and reinvigorate Epcot. And that's really exciting because they're going to keep in heart and in mind what Epcot was supposed to be. And I think that's really, really exciting.
Yeah, I think it'll still keep its heart. Oh, and Ratatouille ride.
Yes. So
that's exciting.
The Ratatouille ride that they're building in France, which should be really cool. There was no news about another pavilion, which kind of stinks. And then also the restaurant that's going to be built right next to Mission Space, which is supposed to look like you're in space eating dinner with an insane view, which is pretty freaking cool.
Yeah, the pictures, like the concept art looked really neat. It looks like it'd be a fun place to eat.
Yeah, so I mean, okay, so the one thing that I just teased you with that we were talking about, so at the end of the Parks and Resorts panel, they blew us out of the water. They told us this story about this little boy with autism. He just wanted a green balloon, and his mom went on this adventure to get it, and she got it from these really incredible cast members.
Who
got one special for her to give to them. And the cast members came out with all these green balloons and gave out green balloons for some people. Whoever got one, Nikki got one, that's right above us at the moment, floating, following us like an omen. But the more important thing that they did was they showed us some footage of the new Fantasmic scenes, and they gave everybody in the room a Fantasmic lanyard that allows us to get in line for Stage Pass, which is kind of like Fast Pass for the rooms and the store. And we get a wristband to see Fantasmic, either two shows tonight or two shows tomorrow. We have to choose one show to go see, which is really freaking cool to do.
Because it doesn't open till Monday.
Yeah, so they're opening it up for Disneyland's birthday. So that's really, really cool.
Also, a thing I'm excited about is the Tron ride that's coming to the Magic Kingdom.
Yes, so they have a Tron ride coming to Magic Kingdom. It's going to pretty much be the exact same thing that we have here in Shanghai. Just placed right next to Space Mountain, kind of in a new plot of land. So if you look at an overhead view of Tomorrowland at Magic Kingdom in Florida, you'll see that there is just this gigantic patch of trees, and it's going to go right there. So somebody that actually kind of photoshopped it together that I saw first was Rich over at the One Little Spark podcast. He actually photoshopped a overhead picture of Tron into that spot. So he actually got it right, but they're going to be building a lot more around that. So I'm wondering if they're going to have to move the railroad because of that at all.
I think when they built Walt Disney World and the Magic Kingdom in particular, they planned on expansion. So there's a lot of empty space.
Yes.
In between the railroad and the actual park. Like, you go way out there when you're riding it.
I think it just doesn't seem that way, especially given if you look at it from the overhead view. I think it just doesn't look like it. But I think you're right. I think you are right. There is probably going to be plenty of room for them to build an attraction. So I'm really looking forward to that. A lot of the stuff that we wanted to know, they didn't know anything. We got a little disappointed. There's no news on the future of Figment and Journey into Imagination or what they're planning to do. I really wish they said something about the future of Figment and Journey into Imagination, because I know a lot of Disney fans are really curious and also really, really worried about the future of our purple friend.
They were also very, very vague on the developments in California Adventure.
Yes, so they were very, very vague on the Pixar overlay of things and how it's going to work and things like that.
I was talking mostly about the Marvel stuff.
Oh, yeah. They basically just said, hey, Marvel's coming and Avengers and Spider-Man are going to be involved. And everyone's like, and?
That was it. That's all they said.
It's literally like they didn't want to tell us everything. It's like, come on, guys.
You know what?
You just told us it was coming. Why don't you just tell us who's getting rides, who's not? I don't care if you tell us what kind of rides they are. Just freaking tell us.
Honestly, I think they're saving stuff for 2019.
Do you think they're saving stuff for 2019?
Like, I do. Because Star Wars is going to be finished in 2018. So they're not going to start like groundbreaking or developing anything in California Adventure till after that. So they are saving this as a big announcement for 2019. I guarantee it.
Yeah, it seems like that, which kind of bugs me a little bit.
Yeah.
It's like you're announcing it. Just announce it now. Everybody already probably knows what you're doing. A lot of the rumors that were online came true with certain rides that are being built. Why not just say it? Seriously, just say it.
Yeah.
And then also with regards to Walt Disney World news, they went into depth on the gondolas, or how Chapek likes to say it, gondolas.
Gondolas.
Those
but
freaking
what are they
gondolas.
Actually, I forgot what they're going to be called. Sky something?
Skyliner.
Skyliner.
So it's going to be the Disney Skyliner, and there's going to be four different actual designs to them, which have different characters on them. And surprisingly, one of them actually has the Hitchhiking Ghost, which is very funny, and I'm glad that they're actually utilizing the Hitchhiking Ghost in other spots around the park, which is funny because it's supposed to follow you home.
Yeah, it looked really cool.
I'm glad they just actually like thought about it.
Yeah.
Like, they actually sat there and thought instead of like, let's put Mickey on one and Goofy on the other and Donald on the other and Minnie on the other. Let's call it a day. No, they actually thought about it and like, hey, let's actually throw something else on there, which I like. I like that they thought about it. So, I mean, other than that, I think that the Parks and Resorts panel, which pretty much took up the entire day.
Yeah, we were either waiting in line for it before, or now we're waiting in line for it after to get the giveaway.
Yeah.
So, that was our whole day.
I think it was worth it because of the showmanship that happened in the panel. It was really cool because they, like, the Disney panels here for the big rooms, I can't really speak too much for the arena because we haven't really been in there. They really put on a show. There's always singers, there's always dancers, there's always something going on. And something that we really failed to mention that was freaking awesome. So the panel started, and somebody walked out into the middle of the whole like center where everyone's sitting, and just stands up and starts singing. And then other people start standing up, and right in front of us, somebody stood up and started singing. And we thought that they were part of the audience.
Yeah.
Like, that's absolutely insane.
They were all dressed up as parkgoers, you know, with like hats and ears and, you know, casual outfits on.
Yeah, so that was really, really cool. And, like, it shocked me.
Yeah.
I was actually periscoping the entire thing, and I was like, oh my God, and then I put the camera on him and everything. So
it was
that
a good
really
opening.
Cool. No, it was a very good opening. Then I had a really touching moment and show. But sorry, people. Dry throat. A little water today. They had a part where they actually sang songs from different attractions from, and like shows and attractions from years past. So obviously they started off with Wishes, then they went to the Golden Horseshoe Review. What else did they sing? They sang A Great Big Beautiful Tomorrow from the Carousel of Progress, which was really, really fun and really, really cool that they did that. I really liked it because they were really focusing on the theme park aspect of all this. It isn't just like, when you wish upon a star. It's like, no, this is the theme park stuff, and they sang the stuff that people loved. When Great Big Beautiful Tomorrow came up, everybody was singing it. It was insanity. So that was really, really cool of them to do that. And I was singing. I know you were singing.
Yeah, we were all singing. And then their other little show moment that they did during the panel was they announced that on one of their cruise ships they were going to have, or probably several of their cruise ships, they were going to do Beauty and the Beast, like,
and
play, like,
and
live.
Off of the new movie.
Yeah, based on the movie. And so all of the enchanted furniture and all that, like, you know, Lumiere and all that, were going to be puppets. Which is different because usually there are people in giant, you know, Mrs. Potts suits and
their
giant plates.
Sticking out
and,
of it like monstrosities.
Yeah, so, I mean, they showed a video clip and it looked really cool. And then they had a few people sing like a medley of songs from Beauty and the Beast. That was really fun.
And they were all the characters though, because at the same time they were showing a video of behind the scenes and then practicing with some prototype stuff.
Yeah,
which
puppetry.
Was really cool. And all the people on stage were all the people that were in the show.
Yeah.
Which was really cool. So the Beast was there and all that stuff and the Lumiere and everything. So that was really, really, really fun. Altogether, I think the Parks and Resorts was a really good mix of things that we were disappointed about, not hearing, things that we were really excited to hear that were confirmed, rumors that were confirmed, rumors that were denied, things of that nature. But a lot of it was stuff that we saw coming from a mile away, which honestly I'm fine with ultimately because it's just what we wanted to hear. It was just the few things that we've been wanting to hear and we still didn't hear yet that people were upset about.
Yeah, and we got some confirmations on rumors and things like that.
Yeah, so, I mean, it was a good time. I'm glad that we did it. I know that it took up a lot of time to go to and things like that, so that wasn't fun, but it was worth getting into and I'm really glad that we did it and they put on a great show. And I just can't wait for tomorrow, day 3 of D23.
Yep, and Fantasmic, hopefully.
Oh my goodness, hopefully. I mean, we're almost there. We still have like a good halfway to go.
Yeah.
And Nikki currently is walking backwards, holding the microphone in her hand as I direct her with my hands, telling her when to keep walking and when to stop so she doesn't run over people like a bull in a china shop.
So if I sound a little quieter every once in a while, it's because I'm trying to see where I'm walking.
Pretty much. That's accurate. So tonight, we are actually going to a premiere of a movie.
Yes, Foolish Mortals.
Yeah, so Foolish Mortals, it was directed by one of our friends, James, and we're really excited to see his work. It's all about the fans of the Haunted Mansion and the community that's around that, so we are super, super excited.
Yep, can't wait.
So, we'll leave you here for now. Obviously, we're going to talk a little bit more about this on the bumpers at the beginning and end, which you'll have heard the beginning already, and you'll hear the end. We'll briefly touch upon a lot of the stuff in our experience at the expo and stuff like that, so just make sure you tune in for the rest of the show.
Yep.
So, thanks for tuning in, guys, and we'll see you and talk to you in just a second. It's like time travel for you guys, well, not for us, though, because we have to wait a while. But for you guys, our long while is your short
while.
Yeah,
we're taking the long way.
Literally, we're going to see you right now.
Bye.
So, surprise, surprise, we're back, and we're actually sitting down relaxing here for a second with a couple good friends. Introduce yourselves, people.
Hello, I'm Kevin Kalbfeld. I'm glad to be back on the show.
Yeah, you've been on our show before. I don't know why you're here again. I don't understand how that happens.
Because I followed you around the convention, Gabe.
Literally, he was just right behind us, holding onto my backpack, kind of like a monkey, just like crouched right on top.
People thought I was a Yoda cosplay.
That is true. So we're also joined by...
Justin Martin. It's my first time on any kind of show, so this is very exciting. So I also stalked Gabe around the convention today.
He was on top of your back.
Yes. Yeah,
and there's a bromance that happens here that's just very beautiful.
It's very, yeah.
But we're sitting down because you guys wanted to talk about the Parks and Resorts panel that we just got out of. So I'm sure both of you guys, because you work in the industry, you have a lot of opinions. Oh, by the way, Nikki's here too.
Hi.
That's Nikki.
The other part of the duo that I rudely didn't introduce.
If you guys don't hear from me much this segment, that's fine. I'm tired.
Blame the other two.
Uno.
Yeah. The theme park Uno, yeah. So since you guys work in the industry, I know that a lot of these announcements probably meant a lot to you, as well as you guys are looking at it from a completely different perspective than Nikki and I are, and the normal guest, I guess you could say. What were your impressions of the announcements, and what were some of the more standouts, and what are you sad that they didn't announce? Which I know that was something you guys were looking forward to seeing what they didn't announce. So,
well, I guess the fun stuff was realizing that this isn't a theme park like convention. This is clearly a Disney fan convention. Where it's like, you know, it starts out with the big musical number, and every now and then there was, and I feel bad because I started laughing halfway through the musical numbers. Not because it was bad, it was inherently very good. It was just, I remembered where I was. Where I was like, oh, that's right. And certain things, like they announced the Guardians ride in Epcot, and everyone freaks out and everyone's completely placated by that. And then Justin and I are like, wait, what's the ride system? Like, what? They didn't say anything. They just put up a pretty picture. Yeah. So it's like not a theme park thing. It's a Disney thing, but it's still fun.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think some of the funny things, we got off and out of the panel, and the first thing I said was, like, I need to get my hands on some of the high-res photos of the illustrations, because I just want to dissect, like, the artwork that was done behind all of the things.
Especially that Epcot one.
Yeah, and then there was little things of, like, oh, they announced this new theater for Magic Kingdom. Great. But what's the show? And, like, you know, how many seats are in the theater? So I think, obviously, all weekend, Star Wars has been the biggest presence for the parks and resorts in general. So seeing the model, kind of getting a little bit more of a taste of what we're going to see in the land, and then just going crazy on everything else that we're going to be doing, or seeing, celebrating primarily the 50th of Disney World, and then all the little things sprinkled in here at Disneyland as well.
What I found very interesting was their lack of acknowledging what rides are closing and what buildings are closing in order to make room for these new attractions. And I know that, just to kind of piggyback off of what you had just mentioned, you talked about the new theater that they're going to be putting in Main Street USA at Magic Kingdom. I looked at Nikki and I was like, that thing looks like a monstrosity. It's going to look really weird thematically
yeah, right?
in Main Street USA.
I agree. I don't know what to add to that. I was really mad they didn't announce what show was going to be in it.
I can only imagine that they're probably going to take something that already exists and drop it in there. I have no idea. But it bothered me that thematically it doesn't look like anything else on mainstream.
I have a feeling even Disney has no idea. Like that, the thing is, it's not that when they don't announce something, it's because they want to keep it from the fans, because like there are clearly guests that are huge fans of Disney parks. It's because they don't yet know what's going to go in. Not to a fault of Disney's, it's just they like to get it out there once. Okay, we're definitely building a theater. What's going inside? We don't know, but we need this to deal with this capacity issue in this park.
Yeah, I think if I had to guess of what we were standing in line getting our fast passes for Fantasmic, and I was speculating with Ben. And we were saying that the only thing we can really hypothetically see them is just another one of, they've done a great job of making Mickey and the Magical Map and then improving on them in every park around the world.
Yeah.
That was my first guess of what we could see there. So that'd be a lot of fun.
It makes a lot of sense, also because they have the Mickey meet and greet on Main Street USA, so that makes a lot of sense.
Yeah.
I mean, speaking of Mickey as well, we got the CP of the Mickey ride. And yet again, like you said, they didn't talk about what's leaving for that, because I think after the backlash from Guardians, granted, Guardians open now, like Bob Chapek said, it's like, it's the highest guest-rated attraction on the Disneyland Resort property, and people are loving it now, but when they first announced the Tower of Terror was going, people were freaking out, flipping out, very angry about that. So I think if he also said the Great Movie Ride is going,
yeah,
for this, I mean, not, the Mickey Ride looks great, yeah, but if the Great Movie Ride was going, it would have a similar reaction.
Absolutely.
I feel like there's a different level compared to, if you're comparing Great Movie Ride,
yeah,
to Tower of Terror. Also because Great Movie Ride has declined in quality significantly since its arrival in the park, yeah, too. So maybe just because of that, maybe they're... might not be such a big of a backlash.
Yeah.
But still, I doubt they want any type of backlash at all in a panel. They want to stick to like the positives.
Yeah.
Did you also notice that there was a very big lack of mentioning at all to the upgrades coming to Pirates of the Caribbean? They didn't mention anything of that. And I think it's because they would have about 8,000 very angry people. And yeah, I doubt they're going to announce something when there's that many people right in front of them.
I think that kind of goes along. We weren't going to expect to see whatever side of the political spectrum you're on, you weren't going to see the sneak preview of the Donald Trump audio animatronic for the Hall of Presidents at the same time. And I'm glad they stayed away from any things that were controversial already within the theme park fan community, and really push to, this is what we can look forward to in the industry, obviously primarily Disney, and things that we can really look forward to seeing in the next 2, 3, 4 years.
What do you guys think about the Space Station Hotel?
I had heard of
it. I thought that I would be like nervous or claustrophobic or something, but not being able to see the outside ever, it scared me.
And yeah, because logistically, how is this thing going to even work? Because you're coming on buses. Are buses going to come into like a terminal and close the door? Like, there's a lot of logistics issues here.
The beauty is, I really think it's just going to come down to, look, they've got a new parkland with beautiful infrastructure for interactivity, which is what they were talking about, is, if you ruin the Millennium Falcon, a bounty hunter may come after you in the cantina or something like that. So they've already got that thematic infrastructure in there. They build it towards the hotel. They link the hotel and the park, and you sort of have that long-form storytelling. Granted, there's going to still be those similar touch points of probably a bus or some sort of conveyance that gets you to the park. Nonetheless, to get to Star Wars Land, you've probably got to walk through the gates. You've probably got to walk under the train station. That's not going to change.
But part of me almost is curious about that, because there was a cruise line announcement, but this really reminds me of a cruise line experience that, yes, Disney puts on, but just on land, where it's this full package. We'll pay however much it is to get in. And then hopefully, I got to imagine, after seeing the model, the concept for this, that there is a separate entrance for guests so that you really never have to leave that story. Because I think while the land is actually going to be spectacular, I think almost the hotel could be something even more spectacular that we were not even expecting to see at all.
Deep level of theme.
Yeah.
So like a something kind of like a Grand California Hotel entrance where it goes straight into California Adventure, something like that. It's like a separate kind of side entrance.
Yeah.
Only issue is I have no idea where they would put it back there. Like, Star Wars Land is literally backing up onto the back of house so close that there's no way, if you want to put a hotel back there, you've got to have the hotel, you've got to have the motorcade, you've got to have the place for transportation, you have the place for back of house. I'm like, I started thinking that through as well. And I was like, I don't think there's any room back there to do the hotel. But I'm sure there is, you know, a clever way of keeping you connected to that story.
Well, I mean, they've definitely built underground tunnel systems Absolutely. Throughout Magic Kingdom. Yeah. So who knows, they may just build a lot of the background stuff underneath so they don't have to do anything like that. And then you won't ever see cleanup crews out of costume or anything like that.
My actually, one of my first questions was, there's clearly not going to be any windows, but then what does the outside of the hotel look like? Is it just bermed up and hidden? Or
it's just a whole bunch of wires coming from LCD screens just hanging down, and people are technology. Getting tangled in it.
Wires? Pipes? Are we going to put it next to...
So Guardians Hotel?
Guardians Hotel, confirmed, right here.
confirmed Guardians Hotel coming to Walt Disney World.
But I felt that was very, very positive, that they're really understanding that you need to, like, it's essentially Disney is being like, oh, LARPing is a thing? Let's do it with our technology and make it this holistic experience within our parks.
Thunderbolt. Boom. Lightning blade. Whatever. Lightsaber. Whatever. You're laughing at me. What?
I just think, like, I went on a rant before how it's, like, not really my thing, that whole role-playing thing. I think I'd hate that hotel.
You would absolutely hate it. You would stay in your hotel room, lock the door, and crawl up in a ball and sit in the corner. And then if, like, housekeeping, no, leave me alone. I don't want to be involved in your role-playing. Leave me alone. This isn't Star Wars. This is Orlando.
Why do I sound like that?
I don't know why you have an accent now, but when you get really upset and crawl into a corner, you must talk like this. I don't know why.
Yeah.
Shit happens on this podcast that makes no sense.
That's the best.
It's very freeform. No,
it's very freeform. Very freeform. That's a very polite way of saying this makes no sense and it's a f***ing mess. I'm going to bleep that out later.
No, I love it. No, I think, I remember we went to Knott's last year for Ghost Town Alive, and I remember saying if they can pull something off like this to an IP that I absolutely love, this thing is going to blow my mind.
It's much more long form, too.
Yeah, it's more long form,
Ghost Town Alive, as you guys know, is just day by day.
Yeah.
And you may be remembered by coming back often, but this Star Wars Land, what it sounds like, if they're using the same infrastructure that they've had for My Magic Plus. Sorry, I smacked my hand. I think that ruined
it's
this.
It's fine. You're fine. I don't care.
But they have the same infrastructure for My Magic Plus, where you now have your phone on you at all times. The phone is connected to your account, which is connected to your Magic Band, which then it remembers everything you do throughout the day because you make your reservations. If that kind of infrastructure is being built both in the hotel and in the land will remember you just as much as you remember the land. You will affect it as much as it affects you.
Yeah. And I think that's going to work also with the interactivity. Is that a word, interactivity? Good.
Yeah.
I think that's going to work with the land, especially because they're talking about like how, your ride in the Millennium Falcon is going to follow you through the park. So if you're wearing your Magic Band, clearly you scan, and just like every other ride, it notices you, and it recognizes you by your RFID code. So if a bounty hunter's like, I'm looking for somebody, let me scan your whatevers, and then he uses some space-age technology to scan you, and then he knows who you are. Yeah. So at least in my mind, that makes a lot more sense now, because before I was like, why are they going to be like Boba Fett be like, let me see your Magic Band.
Yeah. Well, I think, and I'm actually interested in the experience between both coasts. So it's coming to World and Land. Where Land, we have more of a locals population, where that's going to be a place that all of us are going to be going, you know, every couple weekends, me every day, and just kind of going back and trying to, you know, get to be a better pilot on the Millennium Falcon and escape the First Order, or join the First Order over and over again.
Yeah, that's right, you will. And then Orlando is just going to be filled with a bunch of Nickies.
Sitting in corners, not doing anything.
And I think it's interesting to see how, you know, the people that are going to book a week's vacation to Disney World, and it ends after that, compared to someone like us, where we're buying our annual pass. Obviously, you have your locals in Florida that are constantly going, but I'm curious if the dynamic between the land itself, the cast members that are working in the land, and the guests, whether they're annual pass holders or day guests or week vacation guests, how that affects the role-playing itself.
Now, I'm realizing what I said before on this podcast is stupid. Maybe, Gabe, you can cut it out. They announced the Star Wars Land Hotel for Orlando, not Disneyland.
Oh, that's true.
So what the hell are we even talking about? Of course they can do it there, but on top of that...
I didn't want to...
You should have!
Nikki in her corner, balled up.
You were right.
I was like, what are you talking about? There's so much space in Florida.
Nikki in her corner is like, I told you. I told all of you. Yeah. I'm in the corner. You guys. Silent but deadly. You are correct. Like
then,
a fart. Yeah.
But then let's talk about that. It's like Orlando clearly is where this hotel belongs because then you don't book your week stay. You book your week Star Wars experience. Not week, like sad, but like your full week long Star Wars experience.
Sure.
that is then enforces your ability to deal with those interactives on a constant basis.
Yeah. Imagine like somebody knocking your door like at 2 a.m. being like, hey dude, where the hell is my money for the mess ups on Millennium Falcon? Like knocking on your door and you're like, ugh. Yeah.
I
want
swear
someone waking
I,
me up.
If I
know.
Wake up in the middle of the night, it's like,
yeah.
I'm like, God damn it, Java!
Yeah.
Found me!
Yeah, it's, I find it very interesting. I don't know, it's all very exciting. And I think, you know, everything that's going on in the industry is just ridiculous. And it all started really with Potter, what, 7 years ago?
Right? Isn't that the greatest thing? Like, take an IP, put it in a park, do it right, and everyone freaks out.
Yeah, and now we're getting just announcement after announcement. We are just, and I was going to say profiting, we're benefiting, that's the word I'm looking for, mm-hmm. from everything that's happening in this industry, and it's only going to get hopefully better.
What? Oh, go ahead.
No,
sorry. I was going to say, like, you really look back at it. I think Wizarding World of Harry Potter was the start of really something amazing in this industry. Now you look at a lot of parks that are happening right now that not just, like, Disney then announces Pandora, which was their first entire land domestically based on a singular IP. On top of that, they have, you know, Shanghai. Oh my God, I'm misspeaking so horribly here. Cars Land, which yet again was, an entire land based on intellectual property, which yet again, that was sort of a Universal's doing this Potter thing, let's go back and forth with this. And we're seeing that everywhere. We see Warner Brothers, which Thinkwell is working on, which has fully IP'd lands. It is a fully intellectual property park. We also have 20th Century Fox World Dubai, which Justin and I worked on it at Rethink, and those were fully themed lands to a singular intellectual property. And I think Potter was definitely the start of that, that people said, wow, this worked. The guests love these worlds, want to be invested in these worlds. And everyone is trying to add on top of that to make it as believable as possible to make the best guest experience.
Yeah, no, I think it's the land. I don't know. I had to keep looking at it. And every time I looked at the Star Wars land model, I found something new every time. And I think the detail is pushed constantly from, you know, Hogsmeade was a great start, and then Diagon pushed it, and then Cars Land pushed it, and then, you know, Avatar with Flight of Passage, the queue blows me away.
Oh my gosh,
I haven't even been yet, but seeing that, and then I can only imagine what, to me, between the two rides, the First Order ride really appeals to me, and what could possibly be in, you know, seeing that show building rise from the dirt mounds, how that ride is, I think, really going to push the boundaries that whatever we've seen before in storytelling for IPs or whatever it could be, that really will, I think, once again change the landscape of this industry.
It's going to be the game changer this decade, yeah.
Yeah, and like you said, just to wrap everything up, I think you said it perfectly in saying that, you know, as theme park fans and theme park nerds and geeks that we are, this is the perfect time to be living in this world because we are only culminating in some of the best designs and rides that we're going to be seeing in a really long time, and it did all start with Potter, and it's really cool to see the way things have evolved and changed and gotten better over time since we started there, and it's going to be really exciting, like you said, to see those things being finished, especially because you can see everything from the freeway, you can see things from the parking structure, you know, everyone's taking photos every single day, so it's really cool to see everything being developed. And I'm really excited to see everything finished. I definitely know what you mean about that model, by the way, because they showed footage of that model, and I got reclaimed. Yeah. I was like, oh my God, this is going to be epic.
Oh,
so,
beautiful.
But I want to thank you guys so much for joining us today. I know that you guys are busy running around doing stuff just like us. So thank you so much for taking time to nerd out with us. And definitely, of course, Kevin has like this fan in London. So let's tell this story before we actually leave right now. Because
my ego needs this. Let's go.
Yeah, let me stroke your ego, which sounds gross, but it's fine.
You can do it.
Just do it. It's fine. We're good friends. So we got a review that on our iTunes account that said 5 stars. Like, oh my God, Kevin's the best. Visual literacy is amazing. Like, it's really good. And Nikki and I were like, that's totally Kevin writing his own review.
Yeah.
That's 100% Kevin. And I don't
remember
you
texted me.
Do you remember me texting you?
Yes.
I was like, hey, did you write a review? Yeah. And he goes, I think so.
No, I wrote a review, but it was like, I love these guys. Duo is fantastic.
Yes.
Kevin,
I want to see more of this Kevin. Yeah. It said, the review said, I want to see more Kevin.
Yeah.
And I found out it wasn't you, and I was like, I wonder who that was then. And apparently there's somebody who lives in London who was a big fan of your talk about visual literacy
in Shanghai, and he sent us a separate message on Facebook. So we found out it wasn't him writing his own review, it was somebody else. So we loved...
That's a very clever ruse.
No, right. Like, I really went deep undercover on this one. No, so he was actually a big fan of hearing you speak on the other episode, so I'm sure he's happy hearing you back on the show. We'll have to bring you guys back officially back at the studio where we record, which is just my office with my rat in a cage.
Okay, next time I'll give my London fan a shout out. This is a shout out to him right now. So, way to go. Thanks.
But yeah, thanks guys for joining us. That end on that silly note, really, right? I hope your ego stroked enough.
Oh, I can go watch Fantastic
already.
Now.
Oh my gosh. Well, thank you very much. No, I'm very excited.
Oh my gosh, me too.
Yeah.
Thank you so much, Gabe and Nikki.
Yeah,
love you guys.
You guys.
Love the podcast. And thank you so much for having us on.
Yeah.
Last night, we had the opportunity to actually go to our friend's movie premiere. So James Carter II, he directed a wonderful documentary all about Haunted Mansion fans. And it was called Foolish Mortals. And it was right down the street at the Red Lion Hotel. With an open bar that had...
Well, it wasn't an open bar. It was a bar.
It was a bar.
Yeah.
And it had a specialty drink that was called Madame Leota.
Yeah.
It was black.
It was black and purple. It like kind of faded from
cool.
purple to black.
Ombre.
Uh-huh.
Ombre. It, is
yeah,
that the word?
I guess,
I'm not a woman. I
guess
know.
It ombre'd.
The guys don't use the word ombre, do they?
No ombre.
No ombre.
No, I'm just picturing a cowboy like saying
with,
ombre.
With like a faded color and
then,
like cowboy hat.
Yeah, but
to his
then
boots.
Some other cowboy like, are you talking to me? He's like, no, my horse's mane is ombre.
And his name is ombre. Because he's an ombre with ombre.
Oh,
this has
man.
Gone far. Okay,
we're
anyway.
Tired.
So, yeah, we were able to go to the movie screening, and it was really, really fun
it
to
was
see
fun.
All the hard work that the guys put into this, because he worked for somebody else, and there were some really fantastic interviews that they had there. Obviously, like, people that we are very familiar with, like Rick West and Raleigh Crump and mm-hmm. all that stuff. And it was just really cool to see the community of Haunted Mansion fans come together and talk about their love and to see the different facets of the culture and from all corners and all colors and creeds and everything.
Yeah.
Everybody just comes together on this one thing and have that one shared love and interest of the Haunted Mansion.
Yeah, it was great. And they had vendors there too. I bought a pair of Haunted Mansion inspired Minnie Mouse ears. We bought a
Hatbox
print,
Ghost print.
Of, yeah, of the Hatbox Ghost. It was this painting
mm-hmm.
that is featured in the movie Foolish Mortals. So that was
and
really
it was,
cool.
Limited edition as well, right?
Yes,
yeah.
It was limited. I think it was out of 100 prints.
Yeah, and he signed it too.
Yeah.
Which was very, very uh-huh. cool. So on the blog, we'll put up all the information so that you guys can find everybody that we're mentioning on the show. So all the information will be there. So if you want to get one of those prints or something, then you can go to the website.
Yeah.
So
and look up Foolish Mortals.
Yes, foolishmortals.com. Wonderful, wonderful film. You could actually buy it there and reserve a copy, so make sure you do that. Highly recommended, especially if you love the Haunted Mansion, like I do. It was just fun to see all the different fans and what craziness they will go to in order to have Haunted Mansion in their life.
Yes.
So that's going to be really, really fun. And so that ended our night.
That was day
night,
two.
Day two. It ended the night.
Mm-hmm.
And then we went to bed, woke up at 3:30 in the morning?
Yeah, something like that.
Because yesterday's debacle of getting in, we just did not want to deal with that again.
Yeah, so we got here early enough to be in the line for on-time access to the show floor. And the first thing we did was get in line to jump into the pile of plastic money in the DuckTales. kind of like
the little area.
Area, yeah.
Yeah, and the DuckTales booth.
Yeah, yeah, and it was fun.
I feel like they got really tired of hearing the DuckTales song.
Yeah.
But while in line, it just got me more hyped and more hyped and more hyped and more hyped and even more hyped after
yeah,
that
and hearing,
to jump in the
and hearing David Tennant's voice like
as Scrooge McDuck.
As Scrooge McDuck, like telling everybody to jump into his money pit. It was fun. And are we going to post the video thing of us somewhere?
Yeah, I actually posted on social media when we did it.
Uh-huh.
So I posted mine.
Okay,
when
post
we
mine
did it.
Too.
I'll post yours as well. So as we talk about this, you guys could go to our social media and look on Twitter and Facebook, and you'll see the videos of us jumping into the money pit.
Yeah.
Just from freaking DuckTales. It's amazing.
FYI, it hurt.
It hurt you, and
that
it really
was
hurt
not
me.
Soft money. I scraped up my knee, like I fell
you
on
did.
Concrete.
I'm looking at it. Oh, it's red.
I'm gonna be, and look, I have bruises on my ankle already. Like, it's raised right here.
You're a big baby.
No, oh my God. Like, my knee is all purple. That money was hard. And
it was gold and coins.
And
what do you expect?
It was like a 4-foot deep pit of giant gold coins. It was very hard to get out of there.
It was fun.
Yeah, it was fun. But I didn't expect the instant pain. But the picture made it worth it. It's a really cool picture.
That is very, very true. The picture made everything worth it.
Yeah.
After that, we kind of just roamed the floor. I think we went to
around.
We did the coffee where they actually do like kind of an imprint of Mickey Mouse's face on the foam on the top of like a latte.
Yeah, that was really cool. And they can do different. It was like this machine that raised the foam of the coffee up into it, and I guess there's different programs you can set it on as to what you want it to be. You could have like Sven or Olaf from Frozen, or they had some like Star Wars symbols or Darth Vader, you know, and then like the Resistance symbol, things like that. So it was fun.
No, it was really, really cool. And it was actually good coffee, too.
It was delicious.
It wasn't like a crappy coffee that you just get out of like 7-Eleven.
Yeah.
Sorry, 7-Eleven. I actually kind of like your coffee.
No, I do, too. It's good. It's good stuff.
It was just the first thing that I could think of.
Circle K coffee.
Yeah, exactly. I don't know. And then after that, we actually found out that Marty Sklar from Imagineering was going to have a signing. So I actually bought his book and had the opportunity of meeting the gentleman, and it was very exciting.
Yeah.
So that was really, really cool. We kind of hung around for a bit because Mark Silverman, the voice of the Tower of Terror, was supposed to be around. Apparently he canceled, and we weren't informed. But in that meantime of waiting, I met Jim Cummings, the voice of freaking Tigger and all this stuff. Like, that's insanity.
You got so excited, like...
Because it's like somebody who's been in your life all your childhood.
Mm-hmm.
His voice has been there,
mm-hmm.
and to finally meet the man behind the voice is just incredible. And he was the nicest guy in the world. He would shake hands with everybody. He would say hello to everybody. He really made sure that people were happy, which was really, really nice to know that people, like these types of people who have been famous for a long time and maybe not even recognized all the time because of their voice actors,
mm-hmm.
are nice.
That's
great. And know that their fans are here to appreciate them instead of like bombard them from like autographs or something.
Yeah, yeah.
The plaid did make sure that I got a picture with him though because I was very patient.
That's good.
So yeah, I really appreciate that plaid a lot for doing that. You got some ear doodads or something?
Yeah,
I don't know what you got.
There's like this jewelry shop that was selling like these ear things and kind of gothic type jewelry. And then they were selling these cool Minnie Mouse ears that were like wire and beaded, like kind of more simplistic. So
mm-hmm.
so they were fun. And I just bought this like $25 surprise bag, like you didn't know what was in it. So I got a few cool things in there.
Are you going goth now?
No.
Are you sure you're not going goth?
I'm sure. I just like pretty things.
Are you sure you're not the strange and unusual?
Yes.
Beetlejuice reference, if you didn't realize that.
I'm very uncomfortable right now. I don't know why you're...
Nikki just put on a lot of really pale face like makeup and black lipstick, so I'm not quite sure what she's talking about. She's full goth. Full
I have
goth.
Like the Lydia Banks.
You look like you're Lydia Banks right now, and you look like you
not
haven't
Lydia
been...
Not Lydia Banks.
Not Lydia Banks.
I said I have the Lydia Bangs.
Lydia
like
Bangs.
Like those
stringy sorry, yes.
bangs that she
yes,
had.
Yes, my apologies. My apologies.
Lydia
but
Banks.
Lydia Banks.
Lydia
so Mary
Banks
Poppins
is the third child that no one ever saw.
And she's just in the shadows.
And she lives in the attic.
She writes depressing poetry all the time. Yeah, that's the third one. The third one that nobody knew about. But yes, Nikki looks like that now, and she's just... off in the shadows, saying really depressing poetry. Yes.
Yeah.
That is truth.
Yeah, it's true. That's me.
It looks
now.
Like you need some sun.
Okay, let's go outside after this.
Okay, we'll go outside. We're going to go Red Guardians actually later tonight before we actually go to Fantasmic.
Maybe I'm just actually turning blue because this convention center is like so cold.
You're cold. I'm not cold. It's perfect in here.
Yeah,
you have something wrong. You get cold in the freezer aisle at the market.
That's true. That's why I don't go in there.
Yeah, so you're not at a base level of measurement for coldness.
No, it doesn't mean I'm not cold though. Okay, we've...
We've really diverged. Yeah. This happens a lot. Goodness gracious. Welcome to the Theme Park Duo Podcast, people. Anyway.
I also want to mention that just throughout the whole weekend, we met, like, the nicest people. Just other convention goers, like, in line and stuff. And everyone's just been so cool. Like, a few of them even subscribed to the podcast already. And, like, shout out to you guys. It's been really fun talking to you in line.
Yeah, everyone, like you said, has just been really incredible to talk to. Nobody was mean. Everyone's here for the same reason. Everyone's having fun. Everyone just wants to make friends as well.
Yeah.
So it's really nice to have that kind of environment. I do have to say, overall, to talk about, like, the event as a whole, I think what they have given us in content and things to do and things to see, things to buy, is incredible.
Yes.
Like, hands down, top-notch, 100% amazing stuff. If I were to go look at it from the outside...
Logistically,
it's a shit show. I'm sorry. Well, before in the show, I said the S word and the F word. Maybe I'll bleep it.
Our special guests were also quite loose-lipped.
Yes, so. They were. I'm always loose-lipped.
But yes, they logistically, with like line management and just planning, things could have been done a little better.
I mean, like, even with the third day.
Yeah.
The first day, they learned that they should use the outside security doors. They have like 20 of them. They used it the second day. Third day, they didn't. They used all the security that was on the inside and only opened like 2 or 3 doors.
Yeah.
So there's a bunch of people baking in the hot sun who can't get in, which is absolutely absurd. You know, and they have plenty of staff to take care of this, and I don't understand why they aren't able to be consistent with their service. And yeah. I think someone who said it correctly was Sean from Parks and Cons. It's like, it's every 2 years, so they don't remember.
Yeah.
They don't remember how to do things. They don't remember the issues that happen or how to solve them or continue to build on things like other cons that are every year.
But also, they introduced a lot of new things like, you know, gold member priority, and that causes a whole other issue, you know, just... I think they need to just figure out what works and what doesn't work and stick to something without introducing a whole bunch of new things.
Pretty much. Yeah. That's really ultimately what it comes down to. So, I mean, other than those logistical issues, the event was fun.
It was, yeah. I had a great time.
One issue I did have, actually, and this isn't even with the expo, really. It actually kind of has to do with the expo, is there are... set amount of rules and regulations that are happening here.
Oh, yeah.
And things that we're supposed to follow. One of them being is that there's no overnight waiting until 10 p.m. the day before. So if you're there at 10 p.m., you can start lining up. Great. That's a rule. People started lining up the morning the day before, and Disney doesn't do anything about it.
Like,
they don't stop them. They honor it. And there's an issue when you have a rule and you don't even adhere to your own rule.
Yeah. Like, this morning, people were not supposed to, like, wait overnight. Last night, like, something about Sunday, the lineup for everything was supposed to start at 6 a.m. And, like, the people who've been here all 3 days, they know that, you know, people aren't following the rules. They've been waiting overnight anyway. And this one girl, she went a little too far with how upset she got, but she was so upset because she got here at 5:30, you know, expecting to be, you know...
Which is when we got here, by the
way. Which is, we also got here at 5:30, but we knew that there was going to be several hundred people already in line because they waited overnight. She got very upset because she expected to be, you know, sort of first or towards the front of the line because she got here before 6. She found out she was, like, way, way back in the line because she followed the rules and Disney... didn't, you know, to a certain extent. They didn't follow their own rules, and she felt like she got, like,
shafted because
of it. And, like, I understand her feelings and her upset. She got a little too mad, personally. Like, just go with it.
Well, and, like, she started, like, yelling at the people in front of her, like, you shouldn't be here, you don't deserve this spot, and all this stuff.
She started yelling at people who are just working the event, you know, who have no control. You know, they get their orders, and they follow them out, you know, so... She got mad at the wrong people, but, like, I do understand why she was upset. You know, it's because, like, people who do want to follow the rules and wait a reasonable amount of time, it's like they can't do that anymore because of people who break the rules and make it harder for everyone else, you know?
Yeah, and that's the issue that we've seen.
Yeah.
But, you know, hopefully you could cross your fingers and hope that there's these are issues that they'll address and figure out for next time. It really doesn't sound like that's what's been happening the past, like, 6 years.
Yeah.
So, like, the past 3 expos. But ultimately, when it comes down to it, what ends up happening is that outside of all those issues, people end up having fun, and they leave, and they forget about all the things that happened.
Exactly.
And I think I've mentioned this earlier on the show, and I'm sorry if I'm a broken record just simply because...
We
forget what we said a couple days ago. But people do end up forgetting what had happened, and then they just remember, oh, I met Jim Cummings. Oh, my God, I saw Josh Brolin with his shirt off or something. I don't know.
That did not happen.
Well, he lifted up the Infinity Gauntlet.
Yes.
His, like, shirt kind of, like, mid-drift a bit.
Really?
Yeah.
Did you see it?
I stared at it. Moving forward.
Okay.
But, yeah, I mean, those are really the only issues that I really saw. I mean, and then also just communication between employees and getting news out. Because you could ask, like, 4 people and 4 different... You could get 4 different answers.
Exactly, yeah.
So... ultimately, I had a freaking blast at D23, just being able to be surrounded by a whole bunch of people who love the same thing that I do. What's interesting is because it's a pretty good mix, you know, of people who just love Disney, and then people who love the Disney films, and then people who love the Disney theme parks, and so it's a really big mix. But it's really cool to see all these people from all different walks of life come to celebrate one gigantic thing that they love, and that's including us.
Yeah.
So ultimately, it was really good weekend, really great show. Loved every second of it. Wouldn't take back any. Well, maybe I'd take back the decision waiting for somebody and then missing a panel, but that's fine. Ultimately,
it's okay. Like you said, you'll forget about it in 2 years, and you'll only remember the good stuff. So. Yeah, so don't
exactly.
even worry about
yeah,
it.
Yeah, I won't worry about it at all. But that ends our show. I hope you guys really enjoyed our kind of like on-the-scene coverage of D23. And if you guys enjoyed this type of thing, let us know, because we could do this more often for different events that we end up going to, and we could definitely record episodes at those locations if you enjoyed it. And if you didn't enjoy it, just don't say anything at all. No, actually, tell me if you didn't enjoy it, because then we won't do it again. But I hope you guys truly did enjoy this, and it was actually really fun being able to kind of recount everything at the end of the days, because it's hard to remember sometimes. There's, like, so much going on.
Yeah, we figured doing it this way would give everyone, including ourselves, the most clear, like, recollection of what we did.
Exactly. So thank you so much for tuning in, guys. Hopefully a lot of the people that were here today are tuning in, too. Thank you for listening. Thank you for subscribing to the show. And make sure everybody, even if you're just listening now, subscribe to us. Follow us on all social media. You can find us, what, Nikki? What, where?
You can find us on Twitter, Periscope, Facebook, Instagram. Did I forget anything?
No, at Theme Park Duo. And you can email us at themeparkduo @gmail.com. If you have any comments, questions, concerns, improvements, or things that you love, you want to, we got fan mail for Kevin before. So, I mean, like, if you have something to say, send us an email. We love to hear from the fans. We love to hear from people who are listening to us and get feedback and what they're thinking.
Yeah, exactly. And where can they follow you on Twitter?
They can follow me at Laker793 on Twitter. And where can they follow you?
They can follow me at NikkiM_313. And
I'm so proud of you.
I know. And I can log in now, and I post stuff occasionally. I just posted my my jumping into the coin thing there.
Hey, kiddies, I just learned how to use the Twitter faces. It's great. I could connect with everybody. I just don't know how to message.
Yep, that's me. That's accurate.
That's rather accurate, yeah. Just... give or take 25, 50 years.
Closer to 50.
I don't know that.
Yes, you do.
That's true. I do know that. I just like to kind of leave it up to suspicion and surprises. Oh, just like the surprise that we had Kevin back on the show.
Hey.
Briefly.
Oh, yeah. Oh, I was still thinking it was a secret.
It was before,
not a secret. Surprise.
Yeah. Surprise.
You already heard him talk.
No, it was a blast to have those two guys on there, so that was really fun. But anyway, thank you again for tuning in, guys. Remember to leave us a 5-star written review on iTunes. We'd love to hear your guys' feedback and how much you guys enjoy the show, as well as the fact that if you guys leave us a 5-star review, we'll give you a shout out here on the show. So,
Whoever gave us a 5-star written review here this weekend, next show.
Yeah, next show, because yeah, that's just what happens. It's delayed big time.
Shout out to everyone who gave us a 5-star review at the convention. We will get to your shout outs, but pre-shout out to the shout out. Here you go.
Pre-shout out to the shout out for pre-shout outs and shouting for prequels.
That's too many.
Shout quills. Okay. Shout quills should be a thing. I don't know what that would be, but it should be a thing.
No, it shouldn't.
Yes, it should be. Shout quills. It could be like the new like fidget spinner, shout quills.
Okay, you heard it here first, guys.
Shackle spinners. Anyway, guys, remember, there's always a great big beautiful tomorrow. See ya.
Thanks for riding with the Theme Park Duo. Make sure to gather all your belongings before the end of the podcast. Bye-bye.